Good evening. This is Pastor Barbara, aka Preacher with Parrots. This is Sunday evening, October 30th, 2016. Coming up close on Thanksgiving and Christmas. Because it's Sunday evening, we're in the New Testament. And last Sunday, we ended at the temptation of Jesus and the ministry to him by the angels. We're going to be studying the Gospels. So it's going to be Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But because usually two, three, and sometimes four of them write on the same subject, there's no point in going on one book, then the other book, then the other book. We're doing it in a chronological order. So we're actually studying the Gospels rather than studying one of the Gospels. We're studying all four at the same time. There was a name for that before they got into chronology. And I was looking at a book that somebody gave me about 60 years ago. But now we have chronology, and I have, I believe, three Bibles that are chronological. Anyway, we're going to be talking, let me end with how our last lesson ended. In verse 10 of Matthew, four. It says, and then Jesus said unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. We're now in Mark. Let's see. We're in John. Mark went on to give the same account, slightly different language. But we're now discussing the beginning of Jesus' ministry. John the Baptist's job is pretty much done. He was a forerunner of Christ. According to the last verse in the Old Testament, which happened 400 years before this. That's a long time. 400 years is a long time for a nation. The United States isn't even 300 years old. 400 years is a long time to go without a prophet. And because they had problems in the temple, they went periods not that long, but for long periods of time without worship. It's a long time. John's job, according to the last verse in the Old Testament, was to present Christ as Messiah. Reading from John 1. Again, the next day, John stood and two of his disciples. I don't think these pictures are in order. I did my best to get them in order, but I think they may have been done on one book of the Bible. So the order would be different. So I don't have a picture that really matches this. John stood and two of his disciples. You say John the Baptist had these disciples? Disciple is not a popular word in English, except when we're talking about the Bible. But in other language, discípulo, for example, in Spanish, it is. When Rose and I entered the ministry, a lot of churches we went to, the pastor was a con discípulo of hers. It simply means fellow student. A disciple is a student. And of course, she went to, in those years, it was 3 years of Bible college, that she was a disciple. And her fellow students were con disciples. Disciple simply means a follower or a student of somebody's ministry. Jesus had off and on disciples. The 12 disciples that he chose were with him all the time. But besides those 12, there were others that were with him all the time. How do I know that? Does the Bible say that? Well, let me reach over and get another Bible. In Acts, I didn't want to lose my place in this one. In Acts 1, it says, that during the days, this was after Jesus was ascended into heaven, he told them to go to Jerusalem and wait until they received, and it's called a number of things, promise from on high, promise of the Father. What it turned out to be was the baptism of the Holy Spirit. This was 40 days after Jesus' resurrection. Pentecost means 50. So they had another 10 days to go before there would be a feast called Pentecost, which means 50. So while they were waiting for whatever was going to happen, during those days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The number of people who were together was about 120. He said, "Brothers, the scripture has to be fulfilled, that the Holy Spirit spoke through the mouth of David in advance of Judas. The scripture had said that one of these Jesus' disciples would fail him and another would take his place." So Peter gets up and talks about it, and he says, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. The Roman soldiers didn't know anything about Jesus or his lifestyle or where he hung out or where he ate. So they needed somebody on the inside that knew those things, and they hired Judas for money. They didn't dare arrest him in the daytime. The people would have had a fit. They loved him. He healed them. He blessed them. People loved him. So they had to do it at night, and they didn't know where he spent his nights. So that's what he's referring to here. Who became guide to those who arrested Jesus, for he was one of our number and was allotted to share in this ministry. Judas was. But now they're down to 11. Now this man acquired a field with the unrighteous wages. He goes on talking about Judas. This became known to all residents of Jerusalem, so that in our own language, the field is called, and they give the name of the field where he wanted to give back the money, and he bought this field and he killed himself, called Field of Blood. From among the men who have accompanied us during the whole time the Lord Jesus went in and out among us. There's 120 people in an upper room waiting for something to happen so that when it happened, they could go into the world and preach the gospel. But they were supposed to wait until the promise of the Father, the infilling of the Holy Spirit, a number of names that's given to it would happen. Beginning from the baptism of John, so beginning from what we're talking about last week and tonight, somebody who's been with us since John baptized Jesus until he was the day he was taken up from us, which was 8 or 10 days before the time this is being written about. It's necessary that one become a witness with us to his resurrection. Somebody in this room that saw Jesus after he was resurrected, not somebody that heard the story, not somebody whose mother told him, but somebody who eyeballed Jesus since his resurrection, and that had only been 40 days before he was taken up into heaven. So they proposed Joseph and Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed, and they chose one. This means that they had other people who had been with them since the baptism of John until and after his resurrection. So there were more than just these 12, because they felt like they needed to replace him. As I mentioned earlier today, this morning, I don't think it was necessary. I think they jumped the gun. Obviously, Paul was the apostle. He wrote most of the New Testament. But let's go on. Again, the next day, after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, John the Baptist and two of his disciples. Yeah, John was a prophet. John the Baptist was a prophet in the order of Elijah, considered the greatest prophet. He didn't write a book. We don't have the book of Elijah. We have a book of Isaiah, of Daniel, of Jeremiah, of many others. He didn't write a book, but he was a great prophet. And John, two of his disciples, two of the people that hung out, something humorous occurred to me just now. I was thinking, two of the people that log on every time I'm on, that's a disciple. And John the Baptist, looking at Jesus coming down the road, is with two of his students, two of his own disciples. And he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God." And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. This is more than just a story. They followed this great New Testament prophet while he preached Repent for your sins and be baptized. Repent in your heart. But since nobody can see your heart, be baptized in water as an example, as something you do that people can see, that says, I'm serving God. I'm one of his children. I've repented of my sin. I'm a new person. So Jesus is coming. John the Baptist has two of their disciples. He has been their teacher. But when he points at Jesus and say, that's him, he's the one, these two men say, thank you. And they stop following John the Baptist. And they begin to follow Jesus. And he saw them following and said unto them, Jesus saw them behind him, and they're following. And he says to them, what seek ye? What are you looking for? What do you want? And they said unto him, Rabbi, this particular version of the Bible is the King James Version. And this particular Bible has it in parentheses that the word rabbi means master. This is the first time I've seen it or noticed it, because most people believe that the word rabbi means teacher. And we're going to come to that tonight when somebody else comes to Jesus and refers to him as teacher. But here, they use the word rabbi. Where dwellest thou? The word dwell really means, where do you hang out? Where can we find you? When God gave, I'm getting something on my screen, one of those pop-ups. Canceling. Are you sure you want to cancel? Of course I want to cancel. Anything pops up on the screen in the middle of a sermon, I want to cancel it. Now, when, and that of course is distracting to me. So, now I've got to go back to and find my place. He says, Rabbi, you're the Son of God. You're the King of Israel. But just before that, I was reading from another. Here we go. He said, Rabbi, where dwellest thou? When Moses got the instructions on Mount Sinai from God, we think of Moses going up there and getting the Ten Commandments. Well, he did. But he got a whole lot of the law besides just the Ten Commandments. He got specific instructions on how to build the tabernacle, how to make the clothing that the priests would wear, how to make the clothing that the high priest would wear, the building of the tabernacle, the size of each piece of furniture, the kind of material, the color everything would be. It was very detailed. And one of the words that they used when talking about building the Ark of the Covenant, the only piece of furniture in the Holy of Holies, where the high priest would go in one time a year to pray for all of the sins of all of the people for all of the year. The directions said this was a rectangular box, like a trunk, had a lid on it. The lid was called the mercy seat. Above the mercy seat were two angels, and their wings touched. It said that between that mercy seat, the cover of the ark had the Ten Commandments, Moses' rod, and some of the manna that had fallen during the 40 years they were in the wilderness. God would dwell. He would always be there among them. They camped around the tabernacle. The people camped around here. The tabernacle was here. Inside the tabernacle was the Ark of the Covenant in the Holy of Holies. And God dwelt always. He was always there. You could count on it. God was there. That's what the word dwell. It isn't where do you go from 5 to 8 or 8 to 5. Or where are you when you're not working? But where do you dwell? Where can we find you? Any time of the day. So now these two disciples of John the Baptist say, where do you dwell? Where are you always? We wanted to find you. Where would we go? And he said, come and see. You want to know where I live? Welcome back, guest. If it's the same guest, I didn't notice a number. You want to know where I hang out? Where you can find me? Stuff that only his disciples needed. That's why the Roman soldiers had to hire Judas, because other people didn't know where he dwelt. They knew on the Sabbath he'd be in the temple, but they didn't know where he dwelled. And so he said to them, you want to know where I dwell? Come and see. And they saw where he dwelt. An abode, that means the same thing. They hung out that day, for it was about the 10th hour. Time is figured by hours of daylight. So we say Jesus hung on the cross from noon to 3. We generally think of the sun as coming up at 6. Now, depending where you live, you all live in one time zone, I live in another. All of us that are on the screen now live in a different time zone. So the sun doesn't come up for you at the time it comes up for me. And somebody living 150 miles from me, it don't come up 15 minutes or so different. But from the time the sun come up and an hour passes, that's 1 hour. That being the case, the 10th hour would be roughly 4 in the afternoon. Roughly. What does that mean? If you are going from Los Angeles to New York and you're driving in your Ford pickup, And it's 4 o'clock. It's time to stop. See, we're going to spend the night and think about dinner. 4 o'clock is you're through with what you're doing. And they went to where Jesus lived or spent the night. And now it's about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 10 hours of daylight. One, and you know, this could be summer, winter, whatever. It's not a specific time, but it's the time of day that you got to stop what you've been doing all day and get ready because it's going to be dark soon. One of the two which followed him heard John speak and followed him, and his name was Andrew. Now, Andrew, oh, that's a cute name. One that just popped up. I love that name. That is so cute. One of John's disciples, the first one, his name is Andrew. Now, he's got a brother that you'll have heard of, especially if you're Catholic. The brother's name is Simon Peter. So Andrew is the first disciple, and he's got to go look for his brother. Then it goes to say, he first findeth his own brother Simon, which is what they called Peter. I'm Barbara Ann. My dad hated his middle name, but that's what his parents called him. His name was Sam Cecil. And I would go visit in Missouri. Missouri is probably most people say. And they would say, oh, you're Cecil's daughter. Well, I never heard him called that. And he hated that name. Simon Peter, he had two names. So Andrew has spent now time with Jesus. He goes, gets his brother, and he says to his brother, Peter, we have found the Messiah, which interpreted is Christ. Messiah, when we refer to the fact that we as a nation, as a culture of people, have been waiting for years for him. We found him. And the people here call him Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Andrew gets Peter and brings him to Jesus. I've heard of people in the ministry that call themselves Andrew because they say Peter was a well-known disciple who God used in a mighty way. I'm his brother, and I brought him to Jesus. I don't have near the ministry that this guy has, but I'm the one that brought him to the Lord. And he brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, Jesus looked at Peter and said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. In other words, I know who you are. You will be called Cephas, which is by interpretation a stone. That's what the word means. That's, it goes on now to talk about two more disciples. This picture would be probably about that time. Jesus and three disciples. The day following, Jesus went forth into Galilee, and he finds Philip. I think this is the picture that refers to that. We don't have any comment, anything. Just they're in the area of the Jordan River, which is, the city is Nazareth. Cana is also, I spent the night in Nazareth, and when it got dark, you could look not straight across the river. Like if I go outside and I look straight across the lake, I can see Lake Arrowhead Village. But if I look off to one side, I can see the marina. Well, I was spending the night in Nazareth a couple nights, and at night, in the daytime, you see city streets, country roads, so forth. But at night, when the lights are all off, you're in Nazareth, and not straight across the Sea of Galilee, but across to one side is Cana. And I commented, I said, there's a city or something over there because of the lights. And they said, yeah, that's the city of Cana. Following day, Jesus went into Galilee, and he found Philip, and he said, and Philip was from Bethsaida, the same city as Andrew and Peter, or Andrew and Simon. So Andrew brings his brother Simon Peter to Jesus, but in the city they're from is another guy whose name is Andrew. Philip finds Andrew, and he says to him, we found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets. Boy, when something is important to the Jews, is when it's both spoken of by the prophets and it's written down in the law. That makes it super, super, super important. And Philip, who's from the same town as Andrew and Peter, their brothers, he finds Nathanael and he says, we found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now, you've heard me mention before, we know, the Bible is very clear. I believe it's Matthew 1:14 or Matthew 1:28. I've read it to you before in a number of versions of the Bible, because it's the one that says that when the angel came to speak to Joseph and tell him that Mary had not been unfaithful, but she was in fact pregnant of the Holy Spirit, he said Joseph then married her, but had nothing to do, they had no marital relations until after the birth of Jesus. So we know that it's very clear that Joseph is not Jesus' father. But those people didn't know it. If it's hard 2,000 years later for us with all of our years of study and all of our years of preaching, and it's hard to understand virgin birth. Can you imagine these guys? They just saw Joseph and Mary in the same house. And as we'll learn later, there were other children. They had no reason to believe that Joseph wasn't the father. Plus, the fact that he was the legal father. He was the man of the house. And you remember that when they went, when Jesus was I'm just checking my fire is going out. I can smell the wood. It's gotten down to something that is rude, and it's filling the house with the, I guess it's filling the neighborhood too with the smell of the fire. It's probably all over the mountain. People have got their fireplaces going. Anyway, being the man of the house, since women didn't do stuff, legal stuff, important stuff, it was Joseph who responded when the priest asked for Jesus' name and circumcised him and gave him that name. So for all that the people who lived there knew, we're talking about now Nazareth, where Jesus grew up. These people know him. He is no longer down south now in Judah. He is now in Nazareth, where he's from, and people know him. So they said, the one that Moses in the law and the prophets talked about, guess who it is? It's Jesus from Nazareth, Joseph's little boy. The fact that it says that here does not mean that Joseph was the father. It means the one speaking thinks Joseph is the father. And how can we blame them for not understanding virgin birth? And Nathanael said unto him, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? That's such a junky town. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? And Philip, the one that went and got him, said, come and see. You want to know if an important person, if the Messiah was raised in Nazareth? Just come and find out. I think that would make a great sermon title. Come and see. You want to know? Meet a man. Listen to him. Talk to him. Come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him. This is interesting. Jesus, of course, knows what has gone on. He hasn't been present. But because he's God, he knows what's being said, even though he's not there present to hear it. And Nathanael coming to him said, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no guile. You are a true son of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Okay, I presume you're still getting this. No. I presume that my camera didn't go off, and you probably weren't cut off, but I was because of my computer wanting to decide what it's going to do for the rest of the evening. Jesus sees Nathanael, not having heard what went on. And he looks at him and he says, behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no guile. Behold, you are a true son of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, in whom I find no fault. You're not a mean, nasty person. You are a good person, and you are a true Jew, although that word wasn't around at the time. Nathanael looked at him and said, whence knowest thou me? Where you know me from? You say I'm a good man? You know me? Where you know me from? And Jesus said, before Philip called you, And when he did, you were underneath a fig tree. And Philip came and called you. And I saw it. And Nathanael said, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God. Thou art the King of Israel. You weren't even here. You knew that I was a good man. I was an honorable, faithful Jew. And you know I was sitting under a fig tree when Nathanael came. And Jesus answered and said, because I said to you, I saw you when you were under the fig tree. Is that the reason you believe? If that's the reason you believe, you're going to see greater things than that. You think I know about you? And you were sitting under the fig tree? You think that's unusual? You just wait and see. Hey, little guy, come here. When I went to get a book from the other room, I didn't close the door. I usually have him. Little one, if he doesn't quiet down, I'll have to take him in the other room. And he said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter ye shall see in the heavens open. You'll see heaven open. And you will see angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. He referred to himself as the Son of Man. But he had always been the Son of God. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, which is another name for Jesus, the living Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus has always existed, but not in the flesh. It was only recently, 30 years ago, in Bethlehem, that he took on flesh and bone and had blood flowing through his veins. He said, you will see angels ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. He has always been the Son of God. But now, he is also the Son of Man. He is a human being. Let me go through some of these pictures. I tried to put them in order, but obviously I didn't. This is when Jesus has three disciples. This would be Andrew, Peter, and Nathanael was the next one. And this is when he's speaking to one of them. This is when he finds James and John, which we'll get to later. And he approaches them. When there are when there's Jesus and the first two, and approaches them. And I don't even think this one, I have it according to the number, I don't think these are part of this story, but I'll just go through this one right now. Later on, he approaches Matthew, who is a tax collector, and they had a very poor reputation in the Bible, because they got their pay, whatever they thought their services were worth. Let's say your taxes were $500, and they thought, well, I spent an hour with you, I think that's worth $100, so give me $600. They tended to overcharge. And their salary in those days, this we learn from history, it's not written in the Bible, but we know from history why people didn't like them. Because they just came, charged your money, and they could charge whatever they wanted. And most of them were not all that considerate. Now we're in John 2. I'm wondering, we're getting an awful lot of John. Before we get into some of the other books, and I thought this was going to be more chronological. We'll get it all. I just thought the order in which we were going to get it was going to be different, and I was trying to match the pictures to the order. The third day, there was a marriage in Canaan, which, as I told you, is not directly across, but cut over across from Galilee, which is also has some other names. There was a wedding here. They were showing up at the bar for the drinks. You know that these weddings could go on depending on the wealth of the bride and the groom, the bride's parents and the father and the groom. And in John chapter 2, on the third day, there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee. Galilee is sort of like a county. As I'm putting in United States terms, it's kind of like the county. It's bigger than the city. It's not Samaria. So, something like the county. And the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. He was just starting out. Don't believe he had all of his disciples yet. And when they wanted wine, they'd run out. And the mother of Jesus, because she was friends, we believe, with the bride and groom and their families. Now, she knows who her son is. She knew she was a virgin when he was born. That's unusual, and she knew it. She knew that when her cousin heard her voice, that her cousin was filled with the Holy Spirit, and the baby, John the Baptist, that she was carrying, leaped in her womb. She knows that the priests and the members of the Sanhedrin spent, Jesus as a 12-year-old boy spent days with them, and they were amazed at what he knew. She knows. We don't have scripture for most of what happened during his childhood. We may have two or three verses telling us of 2-3 years in Egypt. And then nothing except he studied the word of God and grew and was obedient to his parents. That's all we have till he's 12. Then we have a few more verses telling us about what went on in the temple. And then the next thing we know, he's 30 years old. And he goes to be baptized with John. There is so much you and I don't know. We could never know. Apparently God didn't intend for us to know and didn't think it was important. But Mary knew. Undoubtedly things happened. And there's a lot of fairy tales and a lot of stories that people tell. They're not scripture. They're interesting stories about Jesus' childhood. But that's all they are, stories. I mean, I grew up on Little Red Riding Hood and stories like that. And I'm sure you did too. But they were stories. But Mary, she knew Jesus could fix whatever went wrong. When they wanted wine, the people said, "We're here for wine and y'all are out of it." This was not a 2 or 3 hour event. This may have been the second or third day. Jesus said, when she came to Jesus and she said, "They have no wine." This is the one. This is Jesus. Mary says, "They're out of wine." But Jesus is now more than Mary's son. He is now beginning a short ministry as Messiah and Savior of the world. And it's not now, "Son, go take out the trash." Things have changed. Jesus is not just her little boy. "Son, the chair broke. Go get a hammer and a nail and fix it." We are now entering into another phase. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what have I got to do with you? They got wine, and you're telling me that they don't have wine, and you're telling me they don't have wine? My hour is not yet come." It's going to be over 3 years before I die on the cross and become the Savior, but that's my job now. Everything that happens from now on, this is what I'm here for. Everything that went on before was for these 3 years and what's going to happen. So she's saying, "I know you can do anything, and my friends need wine." And Jesus is saying, no, I'm not into that anymore. My hour hasn't come. I'm not on the cross yet, but that's what this is all about. And his mother goes to the servant and says, "Whatever he tells you, do it." I've heard sermons preached on that. Whatever the situation, whatever the problem, he said, that's kind of a stupid, the coffee pot's broken or we ran out of something. come to me with stuff like that. But she knew that if he decided to become involved in the problem, whatever he told them, they'd better do it. And there were there 6 water pots of stone. Now you can see some of them here. And here's the next picture. They got water. Now they don't have a garden hose like you and I have. It looks like they have an animal skin. And there were set there 6 water pots of stone after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. So they were big pots. And Jesus said to them, fill the water pots with water. You and I have all seen a video or a show or something where a musician goes and all of a sudden somebody disappears or they're not there. This was very simple. Just fill it with water. No hocus pocus. And they filled them to the brim. And he said, now, draw out and bear unto the governor of the feast. This one that they talked to originally, not the groom, not the bride's father, the one that had been hired to put on this event, because that's really what it was an event. Draw out the water and take it to the governor, the one in charge of all of this. And they did. So when the ruler of the feast tasted the water that was made wine, he didn't know whence it was. But the servants that drew the water knew. They just handed him, and I opened this before I started the Diet Shasta caffeine-free black cherry. They just saw it in a container and tasted it. So that's good. He didn't know where it came from. But the people who put the water in the pots and now emptied what was in the pots into the individual vessels that they were going to drink it out of. The governor of the feast called the bridegroom. And he said, this is amazing. He thinks that the bridegroom has made a real smart decision. Now, what is this real smart decision that the bridegroom supposedly has made? Well, he says, I'll read it to you. Every man at the beginning sets forth the good wine. When people come in and they've had nothing to drink, and you give them wine, whatever you give them, whether it's anything to drink or anything to eat, even a scented candle, they're in a position to enjoy it to its fullness and to appreciate it. Now, you go into a bar and the people are half drunk, and you give the seventh, eighth, or ninth drink to somebody, they don't know what you've given it to them. They're drunk. He said, most people would have taken the best wine and given it to the people before they had anything else to drink. And then they'd bring out the cheap stuff when the people are too drunk to know what they're drinking. He said, but no, not you guys. And when men have well drunk, then that which is worse, the cheap stuff, but thou hast kept the good wine until now. Meaning, this that you have just served us, the quality, the taste, like I know so much about wine, never had a swallow of it in my life, but I understand there's even a fragrance. I do have friends from Hollywood and other places that have enlightened me, have educated me about wine. This beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana in Galilee, and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. Now I'm going to give you a chance to ask a question, because everybody wants to know this. Was it wine or was it grape juice? Most people who have, I'm choosing my words very carefully, trusted in Christ for salvation and are trying to live in a way that pleases God and makes them happy are not people who get drunk. And so the first thing they say to people like myself who don't drink, and I haven't gotten my autobiography up yet, but when it's up, you will know that I have observed somebody who was addicted to everything they tried. And the addiction with booze came after I was already in college. But I saw the addiction with other things, so I know what it is to be raised in a family with an addict. And things scare me. I not only don't want to swallow it, I don't even want to smell it. But the Bible does not say, do not drink it. The Bible says, don't drink too much. Don't drink so that because you have drunk, for one thing, you're not a responsible vehicle driver, because it does things to you. It slows up your reaction time from the time you see a guy crossing the street in front of the car you're driving till the time you get your foot on the brake. We get examples of having too much. Now, this is going to upset all my colleagues, They're going to say, are you going to tell these people that the Bible doesn't say they shouldn't drink? I'm telling you what the Bible says and what the Bible doesn't say. There's one specific thing that Paul, I think the greatest apostle that ever lived, way outdoes Peter or all the rest. And that's the Apostle Paul. There was a young minister coming up into the ministry, and his name was Timothy. And Timothy had stomach problems. Now, Paul had medical problems. He didn't have the same medical problems as Timothy. But he prayed 3 times that God would heal him of his medical problems, which we believe from other things that were said in the Bible, had to do with fatigue and failing eyesight. Hey, that pretty much describes me, but I mean, 5, Paul wasn't. So for him, for me, it's old age. For him, it was a disease. And Paul understood what it was to have a physical disease, a physical problem that he wanted to be healed from. And he was not against using medicine. And you know what? They didn't have a Rite Aid on every corner. They didn't have a Johnson & Johnson. They didn't have prescriptions and scripts. And there are some doctors, when I went to the Holy Land, there was one of my room, or one, somebody who wanted to become my roommate. Her doctor had prescribed her a quarter of a glass of wine at bedtime or something. And she was running around looking where to get her wine in the Holy Land. It's kind of funny, but Paul said to Timothy, take a little wine for your stomach. Now, I don't know of grape juice that improves a stomach condition. I certainly would never suggest that anybody use wine for their stomach. And I'll tell you why. Because I was raised by somebody. And until you try it, you don't know if it's you. You don't know if you're going to be able to say, okay, that's enough. Or if you're going to say, gotta have more, give me more, give me more, give me more. You don't know that. And I know, and you know, I don't care what your feeling is about alcohol. You know what it can do to people. And while there's not a commandment against it, there's not a commandment against hanging from a tree on Mount Everest either. But smart people know what it can do. Now, the word for wine, and normally I don't respond while I'm teaching to anything that's comes up from my live group. But when it's on the subject, and I happen to see it, because sometimes I don't read it, it distracts me. The word, Jesus was not talking English here. Jesus was talking another language. the word for the fruit of the vine, and it's what most of us preachers prefer to call it, fruit of the vine. But I brought the subject up. I could have gone by without mentioning this because I'm just reading the Bible and explaining it. But the subject comes up, and I thought it would be honest of me and forthright. And you guys know that there is no subject too hard for me to touch if I know anything about it. I felt it was good to bring it up. But think of the term wine. Think of that word as fruit of the vine, a liquid that comes from stomping on grapes. I've got some in my refrigerator. Grape juice. As those of my regular viewers know, I was a court interpreter for the last 15 years of my working for pay. By that time, I was no longer teaching and so forth, but decided that would be a good way of ending my working career. And I was a legal court interpreter. And I know a little bit about linguistics and translations. In fact, when Pope Francis gave in Latin his first Christmas Eve message after becoming Pope, I caught the English translator making a mistake. The Pope used the word world, and the translator used the word universe. World, universe, what's the difference? Well, there is a difference. Now, some people don't think it's a difference because it's not a big thing to them. But you talk to an astronomer about this, there's a big difference between world and universe to them. And first of all, we don't know which it was. And I'm being honest enough with you to tell you that even though I believe it was grape juice, I can't prove it. And I'm not going to gloss it over and call it something it's not for the sake of making it go the way I believe. I don't think it's smart to take something you don't need because it feels good when it might cause, might, not guaranteed, might cause the problems. There are medications you can take now for the stomach problem that Paul had, that Timothy had. And I'm sure there are medications now for the ailments that the Apostle Paul had. But at that time and at that place, that's what was available. And that's my feeling on it. I haven't read all of what's on the chat box, and I will later. And if we want to discuss it later, that's okay. But that's my take on it. I felt that since this subject does come up, and when it hits YouTube, somebody will probably make that comment. And I felt that it was the honest, good job of teaching the subject I'm talking about to bring it up. So having said that, I believe a better translation, and I'm not a Greek and Arabic specialist, but I believe a better translation would be fruit of the vine, because that's what it was. There are many people who try to prove it was grape juice by saying It's not wine till it has sat around for a while and fermented. I'm not going to get into that. I'm telling you, it could be either. I'm suggesting that just because this happened and it's in the Bible is not an excuse for people to either continue doing things that changes their ability to make good decisions and to have their bodies working at 100%. But I'll leave it at that. Okay. This is the beginning of miracles that Jesus did in Cana of Galilee. Remember, this is his hometown, or a few miles from his hometown. It's in Galilee, but it's Cana of Galilee. He grew up in Nazareth of Galilee. After this, he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother and his brethren and his disciples. Later, we'll get into the matter of Jesus' brothers. The name of one was either Jude or Judas. You know that, my friends know that sometimes when I say something, I'm answering in Spanish and sometimes I'm answering in English. Sometimes Jesus was speaking Greek or possibly Hebrew. More likely Greek because it was the language of the people of the day. But it could have been Aramaic. The word brethren, and let me explain this. Whether or not Mary had other children, and the Bible gives us three or four places where it gives us their names. As the matter of fact, when I started out earlier today, I read, and I'll get it and read it to you again. It's not explained here, it's just mentioned, and when we get to it, we'll do it again, but let me go to Acts 1. Those that were present. Well, I'm in Acts 1, and it told who was there. It is not for you to know the time or the periods of the Father set by his own authority, but you will receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses. And then it tells us that Mary, the mother of our Lord, was present with her sons. And now this is getting embarrassing for me because I'm having a hard time finding it. And I either should have had it marked or I shouldn't have mentioned it. Verse 14. It says the disciples that were there, Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James. All were present, continually united in prayer, with the women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. That's Acts 1:14. Sorry that it took me so long to find it. Now, here it simply mentions Mary and his brothers. And in other places, we have their names. But let me go on, having mentioned that, because this isn't really the time or place for me to go into it. He went down to Capernaum, he and his mother and his brethren and his disciples. So his disciples are with him. His brothers are with him. Now the Catholic people believe it's called, they have a word for it. The translation is forever virgin, meaning that when you say the word Mary or the Virgin Mary, she remained a virgin for her entire life. Yet we have the word not in only one or two places, but in many, even their names. In fact, one of them became active with the apostles after Jesus' death, and one of his brothers did not believe he was Messiah. He said, I'll believe it when I see him raised from the dead. And wow, did he get a surprise on Easter morning? He said, wow, he did come back from the dead. So one of his brothers. And yet the word says Mary's children. The word says Jesus' brothers. But we have a large Christian denomination that believes she was forever a virgin. And so what do we do with the word virgin, with the word brothers? They say, I don't know where they get it, but like, I didn't live there at that time in that place, and neither did you, and neither were they. But they will answer it. And I'm trying to be as honest with all of you as I can be. And not just preach one thing because that's the church that I'm part of believes. I try to read what's in the Bible and interpret it to you in the best of my ability. But they say that the word cousins, the word brothers, meant the same thing. And they even believe, some people, that maybe Joseph had children and was a widower when he met Mary. And there were some of his kids living in the household. That would be making up an interpretation to suit what one believes. And I don't believe in doing that. If I wasn't there, if I don't have really good information from an educational point of view, as well as from a belief that the scripture is without error. And they continued not many days, in other words, for a short while. We are about out of time. And it took me that long to get through John 1. The next scripture we get to would be in John 2. And I thought we would get at it tonight, but we won't. I mentioned it this morning. And it's this. I'll just mention it and then I'm going to close. The next thing they did was Jesus went to the temple. Now, I mentioned it this morning. And I explained to you, and I'm only going to make a reference to it shortly, what the problem was. Because when Jesus saw them changing the money, at the bottom of the picture. And the animals, the sheep up there at the steps of the temple, walking all over the place. And he says, no way. And he knocked over the money changers. And I mentioned it before. And when we get to it next Sunday night, I will begin with this. Even though I already have it on tape, I'll do it again. In case somebody just hears the one tape. The problem was people came from other countries. Egypt. Europe. The Mideast. When they came to the temple, they needed an animal. They could either bring the animal with them. Some cases a couple hundred miles. Or they could buy the animal they needed for the sacrifice once they got to the temple. Money changing, the explanation is the same. They came from other countries. They had another currency situation. You go to another country, you have to change your money. Those people whose jobs should have been to assist temple worship. But they had taken over the temple right in front, like the whole thing was what they were doing, and the temple was just sitting there with no reason to be there. That is what how we will start next Wednesday. Now, hang on, those of you that are in my live group, and I'm going to close the video. And until the next video, which will be Wednesday night, God bless.